morning, everybody. I work for ATANet, which is the National Research and Education Network Provider Department. So in a very quick overview of who we are and why we are, I won't go too much text, I should say. Basically, we connect up all the universities, all the institutes of technology, and all the schools to the internet. So we provide fiber networking into all the buildings that you see here on the campus. We connect them into research, connect them into data, and so on and so forth. We do this on a national scale. We were created before the internet was a popular thing, certainly before it became a new cellular network. We were created back in the 1980s, the late 80s, because the universities, seven universities, if you're a stickler for terminology, the five universities and two national institutes of higher education came together and decided that they wanted to share files. It was as simple as they wanted to swap files around. Particularly the CAO, there's a need every year to send results to the CAO, and the CAO played the results, allocated students to courses, and sent the answers back to the various universities. We're seeing them just by focusing by paper, and we'll talk more about that way of doing things. So that was created back in the late 80s, and then in the 90s, the networking uses started to take off. We all remember during the 90s, maybe at the start of the 90s, you struggled to get email from your organization. They might have given you some ISO compatible email client or something like that. But by the mid 90s, you were into the email that we know and love today, and then other services were being there. So we saw the usage in our network growing in the 90s. And we had to change from being a group of seven cooperating IT managers in universities to being an entity that provided for the sector, because you couldn't really realistically easily fund seven different IT managers in seven different institutions, which were technically in competition with each other as well. So HGA Unlimited was created by the seven universities and by the Department of Education through the Higher Education Authority. HGA that then was created as this limited by guarantee company, which is an unusual form of limited company. Basically, we're still fully owned by universities and the Department of Education. From 1997 onwards, then, they were able to fund us, and at that point, we were able to invest in national research network infrastructure elements. So, just before I get into what that looks like, we started off with the seven universities, but over time, during the 90s, the Institutes of Technology joined up as well. By the early 2000s, we were adding other third level institutions that exist around the country, and research organizations, so some of them from the very start, to be honest, people like Dublin Institute for Advanced Studies were there from almost from the get-go, and then others have joined as time has gone on, as technology has developed around the country, so smart they are, and will be a research institution over a Galway research wave and wind energy. And then other organizations which defy easy categorization, central applications offices have not been there from the start. Our own major source of funding, the Higher Education Authority, and right down to the Royal Irish Academy of Music. So if there are somebody's involved in publicly funded education of any kind, we're interested in that, we'll get connected to our network. And as I said at the very start there, the schools as well, there's 4,000 schools in Ireland between primary and secondary, and we connect all of them up. Unlike with the universities where we're running fiber in ourselves, with the schools we ask a provider to provide us with a link to our closest point of presence. So if we have an institute of technology or another client of some description near to a cluster of schools, we connect them there and then backhaul them, rather than backhauling everything to go to a provider, because quite often the distance is the key metric driving the cost. So between the third level and the second level, there's a million people every day who come in and turn on the internet and get it through each chain. And so if we mess up and turn off the internet, there's a million people who want to call us on their necks. So reliability is exceptionally important to us. And that became more so as the 2000s went on. In 2003, when I first, 2002, when I first joined the internet, if you did something wrong, knocked off the internet for a major client, that major client would probably get around to finding out 15 to 20 minutes later. Now it's instantaneous, Twitter lights up, and that client becomes seriously irate very, very quickly. speed of response has also been very important to us. So our network, it's a bit of a description. We have a backbone network around the country, so fiber pairs strong in a figure of eight all around the country. Basically procured on the back of ESP Telecom's fiber networks. The backbones on the same high tension wires that you see strung around the country. There's looped around that. There's a string of 50 fiber pairs, and we have about that long, nearly two fiber pairs on that, that we string around the country. We supplement it in some parts where that particular network isn't going the route we want, or where it doesn't exist. So we're important to be, since we traditionally use different circuits to get there. But the idea basically is that these high tension wires were put in by the ESP. Government said they wanted to reserve some of them for strategic uses, and one of the strategic uses is for HN to run the internet services. So that's what we've been doing. Interesting problems that you get when you're above ground like that. When you're below ground, rats can eat your wires, which they did recently. Took the time out. We fiber pairing armored cable. But when you're above ground, the crows can take you out, because the farmers come out and see the crows on the high tension line. give them both barrels, and that takes your fiber with it, so that has to be patched around. But the resilient nature of the fact that it's a figure of eight, if you do something here, the traffic you use fails to be aware. Automatically as well, so a packet shouldn't be lost, even if somebody takes out their JCB and attacks it. That network, by the way, is currently running at 100 gigabits around the country. Our clients typically connect in at, the larger clients of DCU here, we connect in at 10 gigabits, and then smaller clients, 1 gigabit. We connect in according to their need, because usually the network price scales along with the bandwidth that you're trying to connect. The backbone there is around 100 gigs. And that's not much use unless you're connecting it to something else. So Xenon is a European organization that does this for all of Europe. They connect the NRENs together, so Ireland connects into a mesh of other, similar organizations. So JISC forms Janet in the UK, Cerfnet in the Netherlands, Redeiras in Spain, all of them. So it's not strictly speaking limited to European countries, but predominantly countries that are also part of the EU. But that's also the use. There's a global context here. So you have to connect in to the rest of the world as well. So like Xenon in Europe, there's other organizations all around the world who do a similar job. So Clarinet in South America, or Africa Connect in Africa. But I suppose the key message that I'm trying to get across here is we're connected in on a par with any other country. With any other researcher anywhere in the world. So our key strategic thing that we want to realize is that no researcher in Ireland can be disadvantaged by the relatively remote location we have within Europe. So we never want to hear someone say you can't take part in that project because Ireland doesn't have the bandwidth, or Ireland doesn't have the kind of connectivity. Ireland absolutely has the same connectivity as everybody else, and we're just as worried. Somebody in Germany can get a nice 100 gigabit connection to CERN. Somebody in Ireland, if Ireland joins CERN, somebody in Ireland can get a nice 100 gigabit connection to CERN. So you can transfer the data that you need, at speeds that you need, with the kinds of protocols that you need. Usually it's needed in a protocol. So HN does an awful lot of other stuff then as well. There's a lot of services that are layered on top of the network. Physical network, once we got that in place, and squared away, our clients were saying, well, we need you to do some other things. It's usually the kind of things that nobody else is doing for them. If they want online lecture capture or something like that, there's usually a company out there that's doing it. But there's plenty of things that the companies don't do, or they do in a targeted one client way, and our clients want more. It's a testing approach. You want to see an eclectic approach as well, where everything's connected with all the other researchers and educators. I won't dig down too much into everything. I'll give you a quick flyby and everything. But identity and access would be a major part of it. So people have identities, usernames and passwords usually for logging onto the network or logging onto the student network system or whatever it is. 5, even 6 years ago, there would be a separate identity for every system you're accessing. HN called it Educate, which seeks to
unify all that.
So you need one username and password for anything that you do. And that username and password will also not just be for your institutions things, but for library journals and other things that you want to access from third party service providers through confidence of hosting as well and the connectivity would be the key things. But I think if this is like for Sunday, I don't want to have too much of it. The most important thing is the high speed internet access. A map of the internet from some particular point in time. I doubt it's full. But I suppose the core thing that we make available to our clients is very, very high speed internet access. So somebody sitting here should be able to use the absolute maximum speed of their network connections coming out of the back of their PC or the back of their laptop or whatever. There's plenty of internet providers who can do that for you, but the universities want to make sure that the researchers could also do this at full speed alongside the existing education users. And one researcher can easily create the kind of bandwidth that a large enterprise organization would create. That's just one researcher who's done something that they probably haven't told the IT services department about. Fire up something on the use of clients. And the remit on HA is that when they do this, they shouldn't have to tell the IT services, and the IT services shouldn't have to warn the network service provider that's a big spike in traffic. The network should be dimensioned to accommodate this within reason, certain cost constraints. So high speed internet access is a bit different to the commercial varieties you get. Another one that I suppose is reasonably high profile is secure wireless roaming. Fixed internet connections are pretty much a thing of the past now, except for desktops and servers and machines. Everybody's gone wireless long since. And providing high-speed wireless access and secure wireless access was something that HA was required to do 15 years ago, I think. And we rolled out a thing called EduRoam to do that. So that connects the username and password that somebody would have been using to log onto the network before, their network share, if you like. That same username and password is then used to connect your phone to EduRoam, to a wireless SSID that you see all through DCU, all through UCD, all through TCD, all through every academic organisation in Ireland, and well beyond Ireland as well. So the dark blue countries are the ones who have EduRoam already configured, and the light blue think about it, and they've related with the chat. But it means this one username and password, if you go visit a university in Australia, this username and password from DCU gets you linked to a website settlement. Very handy. You don't have to, as a visiting researcher, ask for credentials in the network that you go visit. Dedicated point to point networks. For times where somebody needs to run an experimental protocol over a network, or somebody wants a dedicated path to avoid firewall issues, so you want to connect your particular network lab or somebody else's network lab, just ask HGNet, and they'll provide you with the equivalent of a long fiber lead, basically. Because say that patch and that hole over there is now connected to whatever lab you told us about in dedicated networks form a very important part for the research community, but also for the learning community. That, you know, you're in DCU here, but DCU has 5 campus locations now. And we also use these dedicated point-to-point networks to connect up all of DCU as one big LAN. So if you're down in St. Pat's or in the Innovation Centre and over by the Met Office, the DCU network is there. It's not separate IT departments. Separate IT services. EduGate, as I mentioned, was the password federation for web services. EduRoam, password federation for wireless services. And some of the services then that we get asked to do are, as I say, they're the unusual ones that nobody else asks. Just throw this one out randomly. It turned out to be a very hard problem. But it's very easy to say. People want to be able to send a very large file around. So researchers typically have a very large data center. If I want to send this file, I want to email this file, but straight off all the email servers in the world saying, I should not give us that. This is a terabyte of data or something. You've got to try and move around the way, you've not having it. You've got to be storing it here. God knows when you delete it. And we have to scan this thing to make sure you don't get viruses in it. Nobody wants to know, so they get thrown out there. You can probably do it with Dropbox and things like that, but Dropbox also have their limits. Dropbox wants to sync it, so you might want to sync it here and sync it there. And if you've got 10 computers, you want to sync it all over the place. So not always a great model for it either. So the while it's on the project, to try to create a browser version where we'll let you upload the largest file you can think of and send an email to somebody with a link and they can download that file. That turned out to be a lot harder than it was to do.
So it's a browser
limits, file system limits, there's all sorts of things to get around. We got around it in the end, so now we feel like the file is evident.html, that way you can go send the largest file. Website hosting. Why do we do this? we wish they'd throw in the kinds of backends that people want. So your average hosting company doesn't really want to upload in Drupal or WordPress blogs. You need to go to some more dedicated hosting providers for that. If you want to stick Moodle as a backend for your site, it can be difficult to get a provider to give you a cost-effective solution. So we do this at a very cheap price for all the organizations in our network. And data center hosting. When somebody can't find any particular hosted model for what they're doing, and they have a server that does what they want, but they need somewhere to put it because it's outstripping the capacity of the local IT services people to hold on to it. Maybe it's too power hungry, or it's just too much trouble letting people in and out. Just look at them. We have three data centers. Two in Dublin and one in Waterford. Researchers can put things in. And the researchers have indeed put some pretty important stuff there. So the one in Waterford would host some large supercomputers for our central high end computer. The ones in Dublin would host lower powered stuff, but they would be still reasonably power hungry things, virtual machines for students and things like that. On the back end, they can be more powerful. We're providing more than connectivity, as I said. A lot of infrastructure there, and all the things that we have to fill the infrastructure up with, backbones, data centers, storage and compute, and the services go on and on and on. I think we've got 30 services or so, I don't know, this is a lot of computer, I haven't done enough. The thing that we're getting into more and more these days is brokerage, because there's more and more services available out there that you want to use. You don't need PGA into it to replicate. So we talk to the providers of other services and we try and aggregate demand for our user community. Get them available as cheaply as possible. Of interest, I think, in this context, the JSON Cloud Catalog was recently launched. JSON took a very active part and we were leading the negotiations there to get access to the cloud resources being made available by the likes of Amazon and Azure. They're currently making them available. The procurement is the big step, though. If you want to use more than 20,000 euros worth of this kind of service, you have to go through procurement steps. Procurement team. HA has done the procurement for you. Now all you have to do basically is sign up to one of the resellers who are involved in this, and you can step over the procurement hurdle and get straight into using the likes of Amazon or Azure. And also, while we're at it, we were able to say, well, we're part of a wider European context here. Can we have some discounts? Yeah, so yes, you can. So 15% and more would be the headline price discount. It's available from there. If you're interested in getting access to these resources, let us know. I didn't want to dwell entirely on what we are and what we've been. I want to talk a little bit as well about what comes next. When I was thinking about this question, well, what does come next? Really, you need to ask, what do you want to come next? When I zoomed out from this, rather than thinking as you know, we're doing HA, like, what's the next internet service we've got to make available to people, or what's the next deal we've got to broker for them? On a very high level, what do we want from any organization, but particularly a network service provider like HA? We want increased efficiency so that your access to your users to services is relatively quick. You don't want to have to stop off and talk to IT services. You don't want to have to stop off and email HA and to say, can I get access to that? You want to get access as soon as they think of it, and to know about it as well. If you don't know about it, you're not even going to ask. They might go build it, or you might just assume that you can't do that. So making sure that people know about something is important to make sure they get out of it. As I said about reliability earlier, if our service isn't available all the time, say 24/7 or whatever, realistically, whenever somebody looks for us, we have to be there. It has to be reputable. So that connecting your computer into the HA network, or in whatever part of the network we're providing, doesn't get you rid of the viruses and trojans and spam and all that kind of thing. And the costs, well, they have to be unsurprising. I'm not going to say that they're going to be set at any particular level, but nobody likes a surprise. The principle of least surprise is known for about many, many years. And the thing that really goes up here is that people want to be able to model the cost. They don't want the surprise.
So quite often when we're talking to somebody about how much we charge for a particular service, they're asking a lot of questions, and it's clear they're trying to figure out where's the hidden charge, where's the surprise, because you sound a little bit cheap for this kind of thing. And where possible, we try to make sure people realize where the cost is power and where the cost is being used. Our model is going to be one of trust, basically. One of the challenges that are set up against delivering this lovely cost efficiency, well, networks are evolving. All the devices are going online now. There's Internet of Things, which is saying earlier is short for the Internet of Things, which is the Internet. All mobile, all moving across networks. So I take out my phone, it could be on edge now. If I walk across campus while I'm doing something, I might switch to the 4G network from Meteor or something like that back into edge room, or maybe even a different SSID on the far side of campus. The network capacity continues to grow. People expect much more higher bandwidth with every year. And security measures then have to increase in complexity to meet the needs of the users who are expecting less and less obstacles in the way. And 100% service availability is expected. It's not delivered. 99.999 or whatever. There's always that bit where it's going to be down to deliver it. Like 15, 10, 100% availability. That just means budgeting for disappointment. And the virtual compute, the things that people, researchers are doing, is evolving even quicker than us. The networks are relatively static things, but people are moving out from infrastructure as a service, finding them with software-defined networks and things like that. Delivering high-flying service, software as a service offerings. And then campuses like DCU and owners of ours like DCU are expecting us to move on to that. Fully managed services. They don't partake of three or four small components and tied together. They want us to deliver them one managed service that has been already tied up, stitched up in an SLA, guaranteed to fully professionally managed service desks. out there in the infrastructure as a service model, complex APIs are building up. So AWS and Azure, all these people are building very, very, very complex APIs can do all sorts of amazing things. If you just dig down into the AWS, the Amazon Web Services portfolio, there's so many amazing things that they can do. But it's very difficult to figure out what the cost is, and it's very difficult to model. They give you calculators, but then the calculators are struggling to keep up with the complexity of the service offering that they have. And you can launch something in it, but it's very difficult to test it, to test every single API, to test what happens when every particular API goes away. So the complex ecosystem then, as a result of difficulty in testing, it's easy to disrupt. Pull one API down and see what happens. Or upgrade an API and see what pieces of your software that you have to upgrade because the vendor has changed the API. And the funding models have not gone. CapEx and OpEx, typically our funders say to us, well, here's a big chunk of CapEx. Maybe spend that in the first year, and then you get to spend 10% of that CapEx every year for 5 years or whatever. But this new cloud services model, it's all OPEX, there's no CAPEX whatsoever. Somebody else owns the hardware, not looking for an upfront payment for that. So the multi-year financial arrangements that we have today no longer suit us, and we're trying to, I suppose, from HNS models are changing, we're saying to our funders, and our funders are looking at us and go, oh, I'm not so sure about this, I don't know where you're going with it. And I guess it's the problem that novelty in funding. Well, novelty in finances, it usually means that somebody's up to something. So when when you tell somebody a model is changing, they're going, well, maybe they're just not catching up with the realities here. But I think the funders are starting to change their opinions on it. I hope they are, because I don't see any way back to the old days of CapEx and OpEx. I don't see HANet continuing to build large compute infrastructures that people can consume. It's going to be third party service providers that we negotiate and access with. So when I said, what can we have for the future, I was choosing, basically, can we do faster, can we do more reliable, can we do it for the cost, you can pick any two. So increased efficiency, well, what we're trying to do to drive this is aggregation of demand, user advocacy, and tools that don't exist out there in the that means service innovation. We can innovate on our core service, so that's where we should be innovating. We try to keep everything else to be something that's just bought in as a managed service. Sustainable, we've provided to date very, very, very reliable connectivity. It's secure. If you've got an engine over here, there's all sorts of encryption and public key certificate cryptography going on. But your username and password is hidden from everybody, including HNet. And we've delivered the on the low congestion tolerance, so nobody wants to see their network bandwidth being choked by HNet. Are the costs unsurprising? They are unsurprising, but they're not low. It's giving good value for money. But the key thing that we want to deliver here is that people knew what it would cost, and they do, but they're happy with the costs. For the future, for increasing these things as time goes on, what are we going to have to do? Strategic leadership and planning. This doesn't happen by accident. You have to think about where it will be. And our users are funders, our owners, the universities, the institutions of technology are telling us, engineers, go take the leadership on this, go show us where the next thing is going to be. I'm not saying that they can tell us what's going to be, they want us to do that. We can't do it without community engagement first. We don't know where to lead unless we know what people want from that. But they are saying that definitely we have to lead this collaboration. That's also being realistic about what's possible. I'm not asking for 20 million euros to go and build some white elephant or something like that. But they need us to be realistic about it. And to advocate to people who fund us, people who control us, people who work with us, to tell them this is what's happening in our business, this is how people want to do business in the future, this is how research needs to move.
Thank you very much, Brian. Do we have questions?
Given that we're talking about cloud computing here, what's the relationship with iCheck?
iCheck?
Yeah, because they seem to be the, kind of, you were mentioning about infrastructure, they seem to be going on that route.
iCheck are similar to AGA, that's sort of an organization funded by AGA and connected into our network. And then the data center that I mentioned, the Waterford houses of iCheck, one of the iCheck clusters.
Yeah.
They also have clusters in other parts of the university network. So.
You were mentioning though that you'd see the model going, that you'll be kind of going to service providers to provide.
Yes.
Things. Are they in that category, are they kind of a closer curve?
Well, iCheck at the moment, I think, are that they're looking at the next generation. I don't want to speak too much for iCheck, but they're looking at the next generation of supercomputer. But at the same time, they're also looking at shift to cloud service providers doing this. So right now, physical GPUs racked into servers, pumping out lots of heat, is still cheaper than buying it off, say, Amazon. But Amazon are starting to get into the GPU business and providing an API for people, for researchers to go straight into them. So they'll start stepping around iCheck if iCheck can get in there and control the deal. And as I said, it's not great when people do that, costs then become difficult to find.
Talking about cost, you talked about OPEX and CAPEX now being redundant to a certain extent. Now that you go to a service provider, say Amazon or someone, a good example that you talked about, you know, if they want to use GPUs and how can you, which parameters are you using to assess what the cost is going to be? Is it energy? Is it rack space? What parameters are you looking at for the new costing?
Well, with the new costing, it's if you're talking to Amazon or Microsoft or something like that, they're going to give you straightforward costs for every single component.
Mm.
The biggest single component cost that I see is data egress. The data, you put the data in there, you've done some compute on it, that's reasonably easy to figure out, and then you've got to pull it back out again. That seems to be a huge chunk of cost. And then I guess CPU cycles that you use up. If you machines, they charge lots more. And we've negotiated discounts on the total charge that you get. 15% of the total bill basically.
So you're basically developing a new business model effectively with these guys.
I think they have developed a business model. Okay. In fairness. Okay. AJ and then
Now you're negotiating.
Oh, yes, exactly. So it changed the negotiation. We kind of moved away from trying to always provide something similar to what somebody else is doing.
Sure. Thank you. One quick question?
I'm good. Okay, thank you. Well, thanks very much, Brian, for a wonderful insight into HE and things we never knew about. Now we're clear. Thank you very much.
Thank you.